today, because at the moment we are at a very crucial juncture related to the curtailing of the COVID-19 infection that we are having. So the objective of today's webinar is to clarify the doubts that our doctors are having related to the COVID-19 management. That is very important because currently our doctors and all other health professionals, they are the forefront in this battle, and we have to be very clear about what we should be doing. So that's the main objective, to clarify the doubts that we are having related to the COVID-19 and especially the management. So today we have many experts who are joined with us and who will be joining with us as well. And in addition to that, we have many senior clinicians who are participating in this webinar. So it should be a very good opportunity to clarify our doubts. Clarify our doubts related to COVID-19 and to be prepared for the battle that is coming up. And we'll be starting with one of the most important persons related to this current related to management of this current crisis. That's Dr. Deepa Gamage, who is a consultant epidemiologist. So we'll start with finding out what's the current situation, because that is very important. Find out what's the current situation, how many patients are there, and what kind of projections we are having. So shall we start with Dr. Deepa Gamage, the consultant epidemiologist, and to share her understanding and the current situation with all of us. Over to you, Dr. Deepa.
Dr. Deepa?
Dr. Deepa, are you there?
Dr. Deepa, you are unmuted. You can talk. It seems Dr. Deepa got disconnected at this moment. We are waiting for her to reconnect.
So we will wait till Dr. Deepa's message comes to us once she has connected. Meanwhile, is Professor Krishantha Veerasinghe, are you there?
I cannot see Prof. Krishantha by that name.
MC Veerasinghe or Krishantha Veerasinghe?
Prof. Manoj Veerasinghe is there.
Yes, yes, that is him. Yes, yeah. Manoj, are you there?
Yes, good morning. Now it's not morning, it's afternoon to everybody. Yes.
Yeah. So, Manoj, thank you. Yeah, I think now Deepa is also there. Deepa, can you hear us?
Let me unmute her.
Yeah, please. Yes, Deepa, now you are unmuted. Can you hear us clearly?
Yes, now I can hear you.
Great, great, perfect, yeah. So what we all of us want to know from us, we are eagerly waiting for is to find out what's the current situation, and you are the person in the forefront of the epidemiology. So can you tell us what's the current situation?
Yeah. Yes, now actually based on the surveillance as well as patients reported to hospitals all together, now there are confirmed 106 confirmed cases reported by yesterday night. So now majority are reported from, if we see the look at the geographical distribution, majority are from Colombo, Kaluthara, Gampaha and Putlam at the moment. So, and also when we look at the cases, distribution of the cases, majority are, now most of the primary cases are actually imported cases or import related cases. So the secondary or the from the primary cases, the distribution is mainly, still it is as clusters. So family clusters as well as friends and the family related. So far we are seeing the relationship of the import cases or import related cases, as well as still it is at cluster level. So yesterday reported cases are also the same. Either some cases are actually reported through the identified through the surveillance and referred to hospitals, and some cases, new cases identified, and we have identified some of the family members also from some of the yesterday reported cases. So I think we will get some more positive cases probably by today and tomorrow. So still we see some linkages and clustering, but majority reported from those four districts at the moment.
Yeah, so in that day, probably, I mean, it's a kind of a good news, isn't it? I mean, so can we say that the community transmission is yet to start with the information that we are having?
Yes, I think, because now when we look at their movements and their relationships, because some people have not revealed actually. So some of them are actually related to health sector also. Yesterday, even though they are not the health sector people, their family members are, some of the family members are working in the health sector. So we are not sure why they have not revealed their foreign travels and foreign contacts when they see the treatment for their relative. So I think this is not a stigma related thing, but what we need is to patients to, when the patients come to the hospital, it is a responsibility of the health sector also to somehow identify whether they are having the relationship with some foreign.
I think Dr. Deepa is having some issues with her internet connectivity.
Okay, yeah. So let's get back to her once she gets the connection. Professor Manoj Veerasinghe, are you online?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, yeah. Now, Professor Manoj is a professor in community medicine. So I think you will have a lot to share related to the control of this disease. So while Dr. Deepa gets connected to us, can we discuss how we can enhance the community participation in this issue? Because whatever we say as health professionals, it's very important to get the message to the community and get the community participate in this situation, get their support. And some of the messages that are sent by the health sector seem to be maybe misinterpreted and sometimes even met with hostility. So yeah, while Dr. Deepa is getting connected, can you tell a little bit about that as well?
Yes, thank you. When we are talking about community participation, it's not an isolated thing. It depends on many other factors. First is to what extent the community is aware about this. Second one is the trust the community has on the information that has been disseminated and the system. And I think thirdly, to what extent the communities actually feel they are comfort within this period, particularly with this curfew on and the limitation of movement. So all these three things I think is key to get community involved. First one is how much the community is aware. There is some problem in this awareness issue now. As far as I can see, there are mixed messages going from multiple sources. First on the epidemic itself. Secondly, on the prevention. And thirdly, what we expect from the community. So if you look at the mixed messages that we are getting, I personally feel, and I'm really, we are pushing for it, to have a very clear statement or a reporting system than having multiple sources, because different media channels would tell different things, different sources would tell different things. Then the community becomes confused, so their reactions would be unpredictable. So we are very clearly pushing to have one clear source. For example, if they are having a daily status report, it should only come from one authentic source through the government. They are, should not allow different types of reports come different places, and these are being shared widely by the social media as well as mainstream media. So people are getting confused. Therefore, we are getting so much of inquiry from the community, what is true? So as very clearly Deepa said, we are still seeing a cluster epidemic, and that has to be conveyed clearly to the community.
Okay, great. So again, can we get a feedback from either you or from maybe Dr. Deepa related to the current numbers? Now, the current diagnosed number was mentioned. Then what about the other numbers? How many are in quarantine? And probably now there may be some who are asymptomatic as well. Any estimates on current numbers at the moment? And also what we are seeing at the moment is probably the infection that has happened about maybe 2 weeks or several days ago, because there is an incubation period. So what are your understanding or estimates about the current numbers who are in active disease and maybe mild symptomatic or asymptomatic, how many in quarantine? Any feedback from either Dr. Deepa Gamage or from Professor Manoj Veerasinghe?
Is Deepa online?
The thing is, these numbers are changing day by day. The yes. total number we have quarantined is now nearly 9,800, little more than 9,800 cases we have quarantined. And at the moment, 14-day follow-up is around 1,450. So these numbers are changing, because in the 14 days have elapsed, those people are going out, but new number will come in. So I think if we look at the exact close contact follow-up, these are the numbers, but day by day, these numbers are changing. So Indika, you wanted to ask about the incubation period?
Yeah.
You mean the thing is, this incubation period, how this comes is 2 to 14 day has come and identified based on the already existing scientific evidence and the experience from other countries.
Yeah.
But the thing is, there are some confusion among clinicians and our public health staff. Even after recovery, when the hospital sent them home, requested to quarantine for further 14 days. So what is the rationale and why this is asked? So these are the questions they are forwarding to us. So I think the base scientific basis is, after getting the infection, the viral shedding is existing for a longer period. So even the hospital sent them home after getting the negative result. But based on the experience from other countries, to make sure that the total period, so we make sure that the further viral shedding will not be there and they will not be transmitting to others. That is why when the hospital send them home, they advise the patients to further quarantine.
Okay, so yeah, so in that case, basically, we are going by the current best evidence that is available from the other countries as well as internationally. Manoj, would you like to add anything to that?
Yes, there are a few things. There are
high transmission area, possibility of.
Hello.
Yeah, hello. I think Deepa's the connection seemed to be intermittent.
Yeah, weak.
Yeah, yeah. Meanwhile, yeah. Manoj?
Basically, there are new research reports or the papers coming out. I was just getting one today. Which is just a very new one. They are what for a mathematical model also, what they have used is as the mean as 6.4 days as the basic mean for a case to come. So from the most of the reports which has used existing data from China, that is where the actual data comes, they say the majority of the cases appear possibly between the first 7 to 8 days. So that is the general conclusion that we can get from the published data based on the Wuhan experience. That is one. Second one, which I just want to tell from what I was continuing from my previous comment. So as we have very clear, message should come from one place on the status and the daily report. And it has to be reported in a standard scientific manner, even to the public. And there cannot be a sensational type of headings and other things, and misinformation and misinterpretation of things. These are the issues that the general public face, even our health staff. Next one I want to tell is that when that does not happen, there is a confusion even within the ranks of the health staff. When health staff is getting mixed messages of different numbers which is exist in the community and other places, then they are not really sure how they are going to plan their own work, including in the hospitals. When I spoke to several people in the morning, across the country, we very clearly see this confusion of numbers and different status report have made it very difficult for them to prepare. So these are the key things in health staff, and the same thing happens to the general public. And one key thing that I have to very clear tell today in the morning, which I experienced, although there's a very clear circular and a direction from the health ministry, people who want to wear a mask can wear a mask. Others who does not have a disease or a respiratory illness can go without a mask. That is the very clear direction. But still, if you go out, you see that particularly police and others try to enforce and send people and blackguarding people for not wearing a mask. So this is a bit of an issue for the public. So we have to be very clear about our policy. If we ask people to wear a mask, we have to tell it clearly. Or if we give them the flexibility of wearing or not wearing a mask, that has to be really clearly told to the enforcing officer as well as the public. Those are the major issues or the barriers or problems that we see on engaging in the community. And last one I want to contribute for your first a question is, there's a bit of an issue as a person with epidemiological background and public health that I see from yesterday and today. In this area, Kalambu, Gampa, we have a curfew. But if you really get into the road, and yesterday I traveled 70 odd kilometers across Kalambu and Gampa district for certain work. What I see, still people are at major supermarkets and other grocery stores. There are huge queues across pharmacies. This is exactly we were trying to prevent by enforcing a restriction of people movement. But unfortunately, it is what exactly happens. So, for example, when the healthcare people are being given a particular time to go to a grocery store or a supermarket, large numbers of healthcare staff from major hospitals gather around these places. And this is a risk for both, for the healthcare staff, plus those who are coming from the outside and the general citizens who will be coming to those places. as well as the staff inside a supermarket. Just for example, I'm just before finishing, I have to tell, if unfortunately we detect to a contact coming to a supermarket and he says that or a case coming to supermarket, and he says in his contact list that I've gone to two supermarkets, one pharmacy during this period, then the EPID unit and others has to look for thousands of contacts, which is an impossible task. So my humble request, I think we have to be a bit careful in this, and if food items and other essentials can be delivered close to the hospital, to the hospital staff, that would be the best, and not asking them to go to supermarkets and other places, which will have a serious issue. The issue is, if one case is detected within health staff, and if he or she has gone to a supermarket, or some other people, a person who has detected as a case, and then...
Very important here, and we are waiting till Dr. Kushrani also joins us. Because infection control and infection prevention is very important at this moment, and especially for the health professionals and the doctors who are in the front line, because they may be having a lot of queries what they should be doing when they are in the hospital, when they are seeing patients, when they are in OPD, and what they should be doing when they come back home to prevent their family members getting infected. So can you share your advices on those areas, the infection prevention, what precautions doctors should be taking at different places, and especially what can they do to get in the preventing the infection, get into their families also. So because at the moment, their level of exposure is very high. Over to you, Dr. Shani.
Yeah. Yes, actually, now I'm sorry I couldn't join on time because there was a technical error here. So I missed the first part. I don't know what so far was discussed, but I just I will briefly say how what the answer to your question. Basically, now the hospitals have to develop a special way. Special controls like management protocols so that to minimize the staff exposure and the exposure to the other patients who don't have the disease. So that transmission, that is infection control basically, we have to now we in our hospital we have a separate policy, separate guidelines have been developed so that the minimization of exposures have to be first thing is to do that, you know, how we can minimize the exposure of the staff and the patients who are the other patients who come to the hospital from these patients who have COVID. So possible, you know, there's a thing like, okay, there can be possible COVID patients. Some are like coming very nicely into the definition. Say some may be just very nicely fitting into the definition of COVID with the contact history and the clinical features. But some may not fit into the correct, proper definition. But still, they can be later, you know, they may appear later as positive, you know, like sometimes they may come with a trauma, but then later we decide that, okay, there are some respiratory symptom or something like a sore throat, and later they have some contact history and may end up as a COVID patient. So there are problems. So practical issues are there. So considering all that, we have to do a risk assessment, and in the hospital, there should be a plan where you have to have some sort of mechanism that risk has to be minimized. Risk to the staff as well as the other working the patients, how they can be minimized has to be organized in a different way so that we can decide like, okay, we know that this is a respiratory infection, therefore the respiratory patients can be taken into a different unit or some separate area, and we can have higher level of precautions for managing these patients so that the staff managing respiratory illnesses, not only the COVID positive patients, but all respiratory patients. Now we have increased the infection control measures in all the patients who have respiratory infection, so that we will not have a chance of exposure if something like somebody develops or diagnosed of COVID later. So this is important, I think, so that the problems can be minimized. That is the first thing.
Okay. Yeah.
Then the second is you can minimize in different ways. Like you can reduce the unnecessary or not non-urgent procedures, non-urgent exposures, so that we can minimize the whatever the admissions and all that. And then we can concentrate on the patients who are there to increase or improve the total usual infection control measures, which are like now we have to increase those measures more in all the units, all the patients, because now there is a high risk of transmission. Therefore, that is one thing. So the engineering controls are important. You can, how to minimize the exposure by having the distance whenever not necessary to go near the patients, and also to minimize the number of people attending for a patient. If you can, now sometimes we have this problem of nurses going for different duties. So different nurses go at different times, one to give medicine, one to do the investigations and so on. But we can collectively now organize ourselves so that when you're managing patients, all the patients, we can organize it in a little better way so that the exposures can be minimized. And also, especially the patients who have respiratory symptoms, because they are the people who are more likely to be diagnosed as COVID later. So that sort of precautions can be taken in any hospital. We know that the PPE is available, that is personal protective equipment like gloves, masks or whatever. But we know that worldwide, the stocks are limited and the production is there's a capacity now. It's a pandemic where all the countries are affected and all need these things. So we have to know how these can be efficiently used. The people who need them, like the people who are working close to the patients doing procedures. Who are generating aerosol generating procedures, who are doing procedures where there are aerosol, respiratory aerosols. So we have to understand this is a respiratory disease. So therefore, we have to prioritize these procedures where there's a possibility of aerosol generation. So those people who are doing those procedures and the whatever the category of staff who are going near these patients and attending to them, we have to provide the PPE according to the guidelines. So therefore, the chances have to be minimized of the exposure. So I think those are the important things to start with. And then we can, small things do when you go home. That obviously these are common sense. For the respiratory ward, now in our hospital, we have given a separate, they are wearing the theater suit so that they are not wearing the attire that they come from home when they're caring for the patients. So they are, they're not less chance of carrying any infective material home. And also they can be given some shoe covers so that they are very happy. Like once they finish the work, the patient areas, they can remove those and have a wash or whatever and get into their own clothes and go home. So that sort of thing would be easier to manage. Now since we have stopped the routine theaters, we can use those attires for the people who are caring for respiratory infection, patients with respiratory infection.
Yeah, so that's very important. Can we have this as guidelines? Because even though you said it's common sense, still many situations that we forget about this because this is not the routine practice that many doctors may be used to it. So is it possible to have these as guidelines so that the doctors have them at hand?
Yeah, actually now we are in the process of developing guidelines in actually I think WHO is also doing some guidelines and College of Microbiologists is also involved with these guidelines and especially for I got involved with preparing a guideline for the about the personal protective equipment. That means like now people are debating when to use the mask, when to use the gloves, which mask to use and all that. This is now coming as a guideline very soon with the WHO EPID unit as well as the College of Microbiologists in collaboration. Now we are developing it and very soon that will be available as a teaching module actually and as well. So that will be very helpful, I hope, I think, yeah. For everyone to understand. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. I think that would be very much needed for us to have very clear guidelines and then disseminated these very clear guidelines to all the doctors and the health professionals. So thank you for your contribution, Dr. Pushlani. Yeah.
And I add two or three points from the observations that I have made during last couple of days?
Yeah, please. Right. Yes.
Yes. Yeah, these are observations and what we have gathered talking to people across the country where are designated units. First one is we have to actually strengthen the triage process from the first contact to the hospital of respiratory patients and to make sure that there are definite two lines or two pathways to the other patients with respiratory patients and to what extent it is being done, I think we may have to seriously look at it. The issue is if we can do that from the very first contact point in the hospital rather than taking them to or going or walking them through a OPD will help us to protect the healthcare workers and the other patient. Secondly, if we can have a dedicated staff to those units where they will not be going to the rest of the rosters of the rest of the hospital, then we can definitely reduce any contamination or contact if a positive patient is detected. Why this is important is if a health worker is being looked at or have a contact with a case without the PPE or the mask or other things, then that person have to be quarantined for 14 days. The issue is if that person has gone across the rest of the hospital for the quarters to the canteen and other places, then all other contacts may have also to be quarantined, which will have a serious impact on the hospital administration and the human resources in the hospital. And that has happened in a couple of places already. So if we have to send our limited doctors, nurses, paramedics, even to the central laborer on mandatory quarantine because of that type of issue, then the whole health system will have a serious issue. So I think we may have to seriously look at it of segregating healthcare workers working on special units for corona or COVID from rest. Otherwise, the health system will find very difficult to cope up with if the patient load increases. Thank you.
Yeah, I think that's a very good suggestion. And also, I would like to make another suggestion as an educationist as well, because everything that was mentioned, all the procedures and the preparation, I think they need training. And for example, if you are considering this as a disaster situation, we need preparation. So can we have some arrangement where the health professionals should be trained as a team, say even triage or the drills on what to do when a patient comes? So those areas are important. What are the decisions that we can take related to training part? Because the teams need to be ready when this comes. Kushlani, Dr. M.C. Veerasinghe, or even Dr. Sarath Samaragi, who is having a lot of experience in disaster management. Any thoughts there?
Can I answer?
Yes, please.
Yeah. Now, in our hospital, actually, I am not involved with the national at the national level currently. But in my hospital, again, we don't have COVID positive as such. I mean, we don't admit COVID patients. So we have the triage. And so COVID patients are not admitted if we get to know, but the others, all others are admitted to the respiratory ward. And then even those patients who don't come out with the history, we send the samples and get checked. And as the previous doctor mentioned, it's done. Like, we have a separate team to manage the respiratory patients. And also, as I said earlier, they are given the attire and all that is done. And this training also, we are doing for them separately, because it's very important how it's now. It's not what you wear, but how you wear. That is very important. You know, like even now, you know that even with the N95 mask or whatever you use, if you don't use it appropriately, if you don't remove it appropriately, again, the protection is not there. You know, you may still get it. So therefore, it's very important that the people are trained, as I said, as very correctly Indika said. Like, so therefore, I think it's been done, and the training is being done for hospitals by the microbiologists. But we are now preparing some training modules. I think WHO is also preparing some training modules on the PPE, how to don and all this. It's like it's very important how to do that, because otherwise donning and offing and all that, because it's otherwise it will be meaningless. Like if they don't do the procedures appropriately, again there's a risk of sorry. Hello. Yeah. So that is important. The training modules are being done. I think some of the training modules are being just produced, but we have to do the training. I don't know whether there is any proper method of doing training for everyone. So that has to be done for all the staff. That's important.
Yeah. I think that seemed to be an important area, because education is very important in preparedness. One final question from Dr. Deepa, and if possible, from the microbiologist also. There are two questions from Dr. VGC and Dr. Roshini. One is, the patients are said to be shedding the virus for 3 weeks. And also the second question is, are there any asymptomatic carriers? What is your current estimate on those numbers? Dr. Deepa, if possible, if you can answer, or maybe from clinicians.
Can I answer?
Yes, please. Yes.
As far as the shedding is concerned, they say that I have read some papers, and the shedding start about 1 to 2 days before the onset of the symptoms. And then it can go on up to 10 days minimum, but it may go up to 14 days or longer. Therefore, the patient who are even the symptomatic patients, they can spread the disease about 1 to 2 days before the onset of the illness.
Yes.
As Deepa mentioned earlier, or Manoj, I am not very sure, the virus excretion can go on even the patient is recovered from the symptoms. Therefore, it is important, at least the confirmed patients, that they keep the isolation or the restriction of the movement for about 2 weeks at least after discharge from the hospital. That is one thing. The second one is, in one paper, they have mentioned that about 80% of the people who are infected are asymptomatic patients.
Yes.
However, what is the importance of them in the transmission is not very sure. They think they are important, but not to the same extent as the symptomatic patients. So out of the percentages, 80% are asymptomatic. Now the 14% present to the hospitals with respiratory infection, and only about 6% of them 6% develop the severe disease. So of the patients who are getting the infection, about 20% are in contact with the health services. So there are people who are in the community who are asymptomatic, but how important they are in the transmission, we are not very sure. They may be important because they can excrete the virus.
Okay, so that's very valuable information. So with that, we'll move into the clinical part. Dr. Ananda is still not here. We are waiting for him. But I can see Dr. Amita Fernando. Pramod, can you get Dr. Amita? Amita, are you there?
Yes, I'm there. Good afternoon.
Yes, Amita.
Yeah. I've been listening to the discussion so far. And what the epidemiologist Dr. Deepa Gamage said about clustering. So what the clinicians would play, that she said so far the cases reported are in clusters. So this issue of like community transmission, is there transmission within the community? The clinicians are not very clear. And the projections, we are not very clear. And also the other important things that were mentioned, Dr. Kushilani mentioned about respiratory triage. I think as we evolve and the numbers increase when community transmission is, if it happens, then case definitions will change. Then testing will change. So we have to know whether our testing capacity to do the testing, we have to know numbers and projections, which we need the epidemiologist to tell us. I think what Kushilani said about a respiratory triage having not COVID symptomatics or COVID suspects, but a respiratory triage. Is very valid and important, maybe not to the same extent with personal protective equipment and all, but you can have a separate triage of COVID patients among these respiratory triage and segregating people who are dealing with respiratory symptomatics from other health staff and rostering or dividing these patients into groups so that contact is minimized and we don't have lots of manpower with regard to that. And regarding to asymptomatic transmission, which is a question being asked, I think it was said that 81% are asymptomatic, but 80% are mildly symptomatic. There can be asymptomatics, and these figures have varied from place to place. I mean, on that cruise ship, 17% were asymptomatic. They had radiological evidence and other evidence, but they were asymptomatic. But the issue of transmissibility, those who are asymptomatic, are they transmissible to the same extent? So we don't really have data on that. So though asymptomatics can may possibly transmit, I don't think they are as transmissible to the same extent as a mild symptomatic or a patient diagnosed with symptoms. Indika, what are the specific clinical issues that you would like me to address?
Yeah, maybe.
So we know that figures.
Related to say the respiratory symptoms. So if you can brief on others also. Now there's a comment from Dr. B.J. Siprera also that regarding children, the fever. So fever and other symptoms, the cough and the sneezing and the sore throat. So what would be the kind of symptoms that are present in day one and as they progress, what would be the disease progress? Can you elaborate on those areas for the benefit of the doctors who are treating?
So we have briefly spoken about incubation periods varying from a couple of days to 2 weeks. And most of them develop symptoms, 97% will develop symptoms within the first 10 days. A small minority, about 2% will develop symptoms within 2 days of onset of, within 2 days of infection. Mostly it will be upper respiratory symptoms, dry cough, and some will have breathing difficulties. Nasal congestion, rhinorrhea is not a prominent symptom, unlike in flu patients. In patients with influenza, they have more nasal upper airway congestion and all. Whereas in the COVID patients, mostly it has been dry cough, fever, 99% have fever at any point of time. Fever may not be there at presentation, but in the definition and the clinical practice guidelines, we have said that any point in time. So fever is an important symptom. Then cough, which is a dry cough, can be productive. Then sore throat, then runny nose and things that, as I said, which we see with influenza is not that common. About 10% have GI symptoms and GI excretion has also been described. Most have fatigue, tiredness and all. Some people will have breathing difficulties. About 81%, as I said, are mild symptomatic. Those who have serious symptoms like respiratory rate more than 30, or pulse oximetry less than 90, multiple lung involvement, more than 50% of lung involvement. Sometimes even your chest x-ray can be normal, but when they have done CT scans, even in the asymptomatic, they have showed significant lung involvement. And because of mobilizing these patients, doing CT scan, things are difficult. For the emergency physician or the point of care physician, lung ultrasound also with necessary precautions may be useful. So of these patients, about 10%, depending on the country and the situation, the population demographics, will need hospitalization. And of this, about 5% will need intensive care treatment.
Okay, so it's very, very clear information, Dr. Amita. Another question is, what are the possibilities of them presenting non-respiratory? Now, there were news about one patient presenting chest pain at Pragama. So like that, what's that likelihood? And what is the likelihood, though, how percentage that the doctor should be expecting to them to present with non-respiratory symptoms as well?
Non-respiratory symptoms, they can present with non-respiratory symptoms, but I mean, in the patients who have present like that, if there is community transmission, I suppose that can happen, and if there is a contact with somebody. So it's a difficult scenario, but in all patients, I think you should assess for respiratory symptoms, and if there are respiratory symptoms, and if they even in the absence, maybe this clustering of cases and contact history should be taken in all irrespective of presentation. I think we should talk about the risk groups also. The elderly in some studies, over 65, those with particularly cardiovascular disease, diabetes, smoking history, chronic lung diseases, malignancies have been categorized as a risk group. In children, it's supposed to be mild and there are no fatalities, very few fatalities, if at all, have been reported. But in females also, fatalities are less. So I was wondering why this is. And the virus, I think the virologist will elaborate on this, attaches to your cells, the type 2 pneumocytes and the gut epithelium to this ACE receptor 2. And the females have less burden of ACE receptors on their cells. So that doesn't mean that we shouldn't suspect COVID in any, irrespective of gender, in patients who present with suggestive history.
Is any virologist or microbiologist want to comment on what Dr. Amita mentioned? And I think Dr. Deepa also want to make a comment on the asymptomatic carrier. So Dr. Amita, please stay online, but till the others respond, if they want to have any responses, maybe from microbiologist or from Dr. Deepa.
Yes, the thing is this asymptomatic, the transmission through the asymptomatic patients, I would say that rather than the asymptomatic carriers, because most of the different countries have their different experiences. So the different numbers presented in different from different countries is asymptomatic patients. It is the asymptomatic carrier stage has not been established scientifically actually, but asymptomatic patients, asymptomatic means they have had some mild infection or it's like mild sore throat and it is undetected. So they are, those are the people, they have had, some people have had some viral shedding, they have shown some viral shedding and infected to others. So that means unnoticed mild infection or asymptomatic means the infected but this didn't show some infection. So I would say it's like rather than the asymptomatic carriers, but asymptomatic patients actually. So it is not the carrier stage actually, not has been, it is not established so far.
Okay.
You should make the distinction between asymptomatic carrier and asymptomatic patient. Okay. Because some people believe that there can be asymptomatic carriers who are walking around and who can transmit the disease. So it becomes a problem when it comes to the healthcare worker. So I think we shouldn't be using at this stage without any evidence the word asymptomatic carriers. So these are asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic
yes.
patients.
Yes. Okay. Yeah, okay. Agree. Yes.
Amita. Yes. Dr. Amita. Dr. Krishnani, what?
No, actually, Sunetra is there for virology. She wants to. I just want yes. to maybe something I wanted to add. Maybe like belief that the more males being having severe disease, could it be due to the risk of having higher smoking? The smoking had been. Maybe smoking is more in males, or is that a possibility? I have read that that is another risk factor for severe infection. People who smoke.
Yeah. Dr. Amita.
If I can answer that, Pushirani, can I answer that?
Please.
Sure. Indigo, can I answer that?
Please go ahead, Dr. Amita. Yes.
Indigo, can I answer?
Yes, please. Yes. Yes, you can ask.
About the smokers and higher smokers. Indica?
Yes, we can hear you. We can hear you.
About smokers being at higher risk. Yes, Indica, about smokers being at higher risk, it's a proven fact. Because in smokers, their ACE receptors are supposed to be upregulated. So they have a higher burden of ACE receptors on their cells where the virus can attach. So smokers are at higher risk because they have chronic lung disease as well. But they are also supposed, their ACE receptors are supposed to be upregulated due to smoking.
Okay. So, Dr. Amita, can you enlighten us further on the management for the benefit of the doctors? What kind of management when they are having mild symptoms or when complicated pneumonia? Is there any prophylaxis that is advised? And what's the role of the chloroquine or the HCQ? Can you enlighten us on those areas?
Is Dr. Anand online?
No, we can't see him at the moment. We can't see him at the moment, Dr. Amita. So, from your point, if you can start responding till Dr. Anand becomes available, since both of you are working together.
As we said, all positive patients would be admitted to designated at the moment IDH, and there is Medical Hospital and other designated COVID hospitals. So they will undergo the necessary isolation procedures and things. Those who are mildly symptomatic, clinical practice guidelines advocated hydroxychloroquine in these patients. And the things that we should ensure is monitoring the respiratory rate, breathing difficulties, which will arise if they are going to go into a severe pneumonia, the mild symptomatic. It will happen around day 4, day 5, like that. And maybe if they go into respiratory distress, ARDS, and things, it will be around day 7. So monitoring becomes important. In these laboratory investigations, if you talk about laboratory investigations, they can have leukocytosis or leukopenia. Majority have had lymphopenia. The CRP has been shown to be elevated in these patients in some studies. The mild symptomatics, it could, and avoidance of, like in dengue, NSAID says antipyretics, paracetamol and things can be used, antihistamines. I suppose majority will get chloroquine. Anand will tell you on the doses and the duration, and they will undergo a period of monitoring in designated units. So if they develop respiratory distress, meaning a respiratory rate more than 30, and then if they have a pulse oximetry less than 90, they have imaging available and that shows more than 50% of the lungs to be involved, then they'll need more intensive monitoring. And initially, it will be supportive with oxygenation. So there's a lot of debate what form of oxygen delivery should be used. We use nasal high flow oxygen in viral pneumonias, but there is some concerns about aerosolization. Also in patients who may not need mechanical ventilation, at an earlier stage, we can apply non-invasive ventilation and CPAP as respiratory support. But again, the interfaces, the mask, what should be used? Some studies are there to show that the helmet, which is like a confined environment, might be a better delivery method of this non-invasive ventilation. The intensivist, do we have any intensivists online? Do we have any intensivists with us, Indica?
Can't see at the moment. Pramod, can you check?
Dr. Manoj, Dr. Dilshan, Dr. Nuan.
Okay, so can you unmute them? Pramod?
I'm not seeing Dr. Manoj or Dr. Dilshan.
Is Dr. Indika Lahra there? Emergency physician?
Can't see. If there is any intensivity here, you can raise your hands. I mean,
yes, or else you can type in the chat box.
Yeah, or else you can type in the chat box. Yeah. Any emergency physicians or intensivist?
Okay. Again, delivery of non-invasive ventilation, the intensivist preferred using a conventional mechanical ventilator with an exhalation port. Where you can have viral filters and minimize aerosolization and problems that the staff can be encountered. So there's a lot of talk about specific medication like chloroquine plus azithromycin. There are concerns with medication because of arrhythmias and QT prolongation issues. Also in the US, I think they have had significant cardiac problems, cardiomyopathies, arrhythmias, and cardiotoxicity. So we have to be cautious when we combine this medication with regard to cardiotoxicity as well. Other medications like IL-6 inhibitor tocilizumab has used in patients who go to ARDS. I think in conjunction with Damayanti Iddamalgoda, Anand, we have used these medications in two patients at IDH right now. Again, we have issues in doing cytokine levels like IL-6 levels and things, which Professor Nidika at Jayadipura University has promised to help us with. So that would be managing these patients in an acute care setting. Again, in the patients who need intensive care, who are critically ill, the mortality is high, though overall mortality, I think it's about 16%. Again, as mentioned earlier, South Korea, China, US, Italy, I think maybe due to population demographics, smoking and other factors, mortality has varied.
Yeah, so that's again very useful, Dr. Amita. We know that there are guidelines that are issued by the Ministry of Health in conjunction with the College of Physicians. So what does the guidelines clearly say about what you have mentioned about the chloroquine or the HCQ and those areas? I mean, does the guidelines...
I'm also a part of the member of the Dr. Shirani, Dr. Anand, Dr. Upul and other, there are other two, Dr. Chandimani and Dr. Niranjan are there as chest physicians. So we have a group discussing this. And as the new, as Professor Senak is also there, and as the evidence emerges, we will keep updating the guidelines.
So currently your recommendation is go by the guidelines that have been issued by the Ministry and the College of Physicians.
Yes.
There's a question.
Again, monitoring this patient, doing frequent blood samples and things, doing arterial blood gases is also in the critical ill. Okay. It's a problem in exposing this staff to these. So we have to relook at our ICUs and isolation facilities, multi-monitors, and the necessary how to minimize airborne spread of transmission inside these units.
Can I add to that?
Yes, Dr. Koshlani, yes, please.
Yeah, about this airborne transmission, I think there are so many views going around. So we have to be clear that still the evidence is that airborne transmission is during procedures in respiratory system where there can be aerosol generation. So in aerosol generating procedures, at that point, it can be airborne for a while, for a few hours. So that is why we talk about this airborne, because we know that we are still saying this is a droplet spread usually. So I think, Amita, correct me if I'm wrong. Now, if the patient is in the ICU, I don't know how much practical it is. If the patient is ventilated, if it's connected to a ventilator And if the suction is closed suction, don't you think we can minimize this aerosol generating procedures? Am I right?
I think we can, and I think you are correct when saying that aerosolization and airborne procedures, the distinction should be made between the two. Even now, patients who need nebulization, sometimes there are now connectors which you can fix to the ventilator circuit. One of our chest physician, Dinesh, has got this down, but it's not there available freely, where you can fix a meter dose canister, to that connector and use that instead of a nebulizer. So that's what I said earlier, some intensivists prefer dual circuit ventilators with an exhalation post where you can put a bacterial or a viral filter as opposed to a single circuit non-invasive ventilator in these patients. And if you are using a non-invasive ventilator, whether you could use a helmet as an interface rather than mask. So these are things that we can do to minimize aerosolizations.
Can I just interrupt here? This whole airborne business came with a bit of a misinterpretation of what's stated in a New England Journal of Medicine's paper, which came out where they have done a simulation basically to add the risk for the healthcare workers, as Dr. Amita very clearly stated. So it was misinterpreted in a more general way to state that it is being transmitted by airborne. So I think that distinction, we have to be very clear. It's a simulation done in a US to look at the actual risk for the clinicians when they are doing procedures, not as a community thing of airborne infection.
Yeah, thank you, Manish, because that has led to a lot of confusion. Okay, now we have a very important person with us, Dr. Ananda Vijay Vikram, who is in the forefront. And Ananda, can you hear us?
Yes, yeah, I can hear.
Yeah. So can you share your viewpoint, the current situation, and relate to the guidelines and the prophylaxis, and also maybe a bit about plasmapheresis also, if you would like to share? Ananda, stage is yours.
Fortunately, cases seems to be going down, but I don't think we should be complacent because we'll have to wait for maybe another week or two to see what will happen. Because if the ice come into a spread, then that's the time we are likely to see the cases. As far as the guideline is concerned, we recommended giving chloroquine and HCQ, one of the two. Based on the limited evidence available. There's no conclusive evidence, but there was some evidence supporting a possible benefit of those. That is for treatment. On the other hand, there's absolutely no evidence regarding prophylaxis. Now we have to realize that chloroquine has been effective in vitro against many viruses, including dengue, chikungunya, influenza, and then COVID. The human trials done for dengue in chikungunya and influenza were not successful. Now, some of the argument that because there's a trial on prophylaxis, that is a good enough reason to give it as a prophylaxis. The simple reason that a trial is being done shows that we don't have enough evidence. And there are so many drugs which are excluded after a trial. So that argument, I don't think does not have any value. So at the moment, there's no recommendation on prophylaxis. The India has recommended it for their exposed healthcare workers. They're the only country which has recommended, probably because of their own reasons of other logistic issues. That's what I feel.
Yeah.
As Amita pointed out, then we use some other measures in critically ill patients, but those again have very limited evidence. However, those are used in a very minute number of patients, because those are the very critically ill patients. At the moment, that sort of patients are less. We have used this IL-6 inhibitor in two patients, but we haven't seen any benefit up to now. Still, they are being ventilated without much of an improvement.
Yeah, I think Yeah, I think all countries really appreciating your efforts and the attempt that you are taking. One simple thing that doctors would like to know, the case definition, what's the most updated case definition and how to diagnose? That would be very useful for the doctors. Would you like to share
your advice? At the moment, if somebody has come from abroad within last 2 weeks, with and if he is having, he or she is having symptoms of a respiratory illness, then we consider that as a suspected case. Then such patient should be tested, isolated and tested. And then if there's a definite contact with the suspected patient or a confirmed case, then again, that is considered as a, if somebody is having symptoms of respiratory illness, then that is considered as a suspected case. However, this contact has to be a significant one. Just casually, say you are going on the corridor and you meet this person and say hello, then that is not considered as a significant contact. So if one is within a closed space for 15, 20 minutes, especially in an air-conditioned environment, then without wearing mask, then that is considered as a, that may be considered as a significant contact, and the such patient should be tested if they develop symptoms. At the moment, there's some panic. That is because, I think, because of two reasons. Probably the numbers we see in other countries, and also because of the fact that several fair percentage of health workers have got the illness. That is the main reason for that is the lack of PP. At the moment, we have our country, we have PP at the moment. And the numbers goes up, we don't know. But at the moment, we have adequate PP. We can use those. So one should use those appropriately. If you use those appropriately, I think we can be safe. And another reason for this panic is this news on this airborne thing. Again, one thing is because the WHO head is quoted with a comment saying this is airborne. I think somebody has made that up. Similarly, I saw yesterday one of my ICU MO showed me a picture in the Facebook saying the intubation was done to a patient within a glass sort of box. The patient was in a glass box and the intubation was done within that. Now, all these are made up by people. And one should not believe that. And similarly, one should not get carried away with the undue prominence given to certain drugs. I think one of the good example is this trial on azithromycin and chloroquine. That's a very small trial. If you read this paper carefully, you will realize that they have twisted their findings. The facts are twisted. That's the worst paper I have seen, which is given so much publicity. Trump is talking on that. Sajid Premadas is talking on that. That's a useless paper. And similarly, then this drug called, the Japanese drug called Avigan, which was given so much publicity, but it was tested on a very few number of patients. So one should look at the actual evidence rather than getting carried away with these news of this airborne and new drugs and so on.
Yeah, I think Dr. Anand, you have clarified this very important area, because there is a lot of controversies and a lot of confusion and concerns about what are the drugs, what are the new drugs to be used. So you have been very clear, and I think it's very evident from the success that Sri Lanka, so far Sri Lanka has been doing very well, and related to the management also, everyone talks about the clinical management and how impressive and how successful it is. I think you have been very clear, and probably the message is go by the latest and the best evidence that is available and to follow the guidelines.
And also, Indika, yes. I think if we use PP properly without getting panic, then we can protect ourselves. What happens is when people get panic, and then they tend to get unnecessarily exposed. That is what we see. Now, at the moment, there's one doctor who was positive from our hospital, but he's not he's not involved in patient care. He's doing some other work. So we don't think it is from the hospital, probably from somewhere else. So nobody, fortunately, up to now, we haven't got any casualties. I think the main reason is that people are working with good attitude and using PPE properly. That is what is necessary.
So that's the message that you want to give to the doctors mainly.
Yes, and also other categories. I think doctors should take this message to other categories. There's unnecessary fear. People come to training to our institution and they don't even want to drink a tea from the hospital.
There's some questions come in related to testing. There are some questions asking. Last time also we have answered that question, what's the best method to test? And there are questions on, is this a time for community testing? And is there a role for IgM? Can a microbiologist and virologist answer? Dr. Kushlani is here. Dr. Sunetra, any of you?
Sorry, I am not very conversant with the current testing technique. I know that it is the respiratory samples are used for the testing.
Yes.
And it's a real-time PCR-based technique. And as far as the serology is concerned, I am not very sure whether there is any serological assays there. However, I heard, this is a second-hand information, that there are some serological assays to identify the antigen testing, but that is also, I am not very sure. Currently, the testing is based on the PCR technique by real-time PCR assay. That is for the genomic testing.
Can I add to that?
Yes, Kushan, yes, please.
Yeah. Yes, it's correct. I mean, PCR is currently accepted and that is what is being done in Sri Lanka. The real-time PCR and also the samples are respiratory samples like sputum, and even now there's Professor Neelika has recently communicated that even saliva may be enough because even that is having high sensitivity and swabs. Actually, if we are sending throat on nasopharyngeal swabs, then you have to send nasal swabs or throat swabs. It has to be in the viral transport medium, otherwise the sensitivity may be low. So and also this has to be transported in ice and in the correct temperature, like 2 to 8 degrees. It's important how to pack this. If you're sending from somewhere, the packing has to be like, there should be 3-layered packing, and the person has to be aware that this is a sample for suspected COVID, and the respiratory specimens have to be transported carefully so that they can, the person has to wear the and gloves and a mask, a surgical mask, and directly to the lab, and then hand hygiene after giving the specimen to the lab. It is very important that they remove the gloves and wash their hands. So those are important high risk specimens. And there is this different PCR kits which are available, like GeneXpert, which is used for TB currently in Sri Lanka. They have developed a kit and the FDA has approved it in USA for this emergency situation. Now we have to understand most of these testing kits and the methods currently available are approved for the emergency situation without much validation, but still they work. I mean, but their sensitivity may be low. Also depend on how you send the specimen and what specimens you use. So therefore, we have to know our limitations, but we do have PCR available in this country in several labs, and we are able to send it. But it's the
discussion this morning in our clinical practice guideline group about the antigen test, the serology test, and also the reverse transcript test PCR test, which has a sensitivity about 70%. So the antigen test again would involve taking swabs using personal protective equipment and all. And it's only a screening test, though the results may be rapid. So I don't think if it is negative, if there's a high degree of clinical suspicion, you have to do a RT-PCR, or you have to repeat your RT-PCR again. Or according to the webinar, WHO, they say that even from a non-respirator site, from an ADEL swab or something, you may have to do that. If you have, that's what China did with, if there's a high degree of suspicion, clinical suspicion. Again, the serological test, the IgM and the IgG will come later, 7 days into the disease, 5 to 7 days into the disease. As a diagnostic tool, I don't think it will be of use to see whether there is seroprevalence in the community, to see whether the community transmission has been established. Maybe doing sentinel surveys and looking at serological tests may be of value. So still what we have is our RT-PCR. And about the gene expert machines, Dr. Chandimani, chest physician, has been looking into it, has been in contact with them. And they have said that the gene expert kit can be modified, but it will take time, as Kushidani has said. And again, it becomes an issue about biosafety levels. Because currently the gene expert done for sputum, for TB, doesn't require a high degree of biosafety cabinet sensing. Like Kushidani can correct me if I'm wrong. If we are going to use gene expert machines to do for COVID-19, what level of biosafety should be there in these facilities?
Yeah. In fact, now I have to correct this. Actually, earlier also the discussion about aerosol, airborne transmission came. Now, if you really look at it, yeah, I think even TB is an airborne disease, whereas COVID is a droplet spread disease. So I don't think there's a difference. I mean, if TB can be done, I don't see why we can't do COVID in that condition. I mean, we usually use safety cabinets. Anyway, we should use safety cabinets to process sputum samples. And in our labs, we do have safety cabinets where the samples are inoculated into the gene expert, the cartridge. Because it's very easy, it's cartridge-based. Rather than a PCR, it's easy to perform. So the same thing, I assume it will be something similar for this as well. So therefore, I think with currently available facilities for testing TB, we should be...
What we do is, if the patient is, now if it is positive, then that is taken as a positive thing. If it is negative, if it is highly suspicious, we do it again. Sorry?
Yeah.
It is highly suspicious, we repeat the test again. Otherwise, we take it as one test is
adequate.
Okay. Because the results can vary from depending on the sample, okay. Collection of the sample, adequacy of sample, and all that tend to affect the sample, the sensitivity of the test. And then once they improve, if they are afebrile for more than 48 hours, after 10 days, we decided to do the test again.
Okay.
To see whether they are negative. And then if it is negative, we repeat it 24 hours or more later. And then if there are two negative tests 24 hours apart, then they can be discharged. As far as the other tests are concerned, I don't think still we are in... there are many antibodies which have been developed, but they have been tested. And of course, we have to consider the gene expert. But the thing...
Yeah, like Dr. Ananda mentioned, at the moment, fortunately, we are doing very well. So, yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes, now we can hear you.
Can hear.
Yeah. Actually, as somebody said, that it is last thing to happen. And also, thank you very much. I have been listening to this discussion. Actually, very informative, and the service that you are as a clinician, service that you are rendering to the nation, and you know, very appreciative. And I am sure with this sort of a high quality service that the very unlikely we get casualties. And also, we pray that you know we will not get any casualty. But having said that, I must tell you that we are also ready. And we have discussed in advance, and the ministry guidelines had included the management of the dead and autopsy procedures in suspected COVID patients. And based on that, actually, we have developed some SOPs. And basically, if you diagnose the case and there's no indication for the inquest, of course, there's a procedure that you know, put into the body bags and seal it, and then we have given the instruction to the funeral directors how to deal with that. Then the funeral directors should put the body bag into the coughing and disinfectants also should be put into the body bag and seal it and allow some immediate family members to view the body inside the morgue or else in the parlor. And then initially, actually, what we recommended was the cremation within 24 hours. But there was a huge protest. The concern from the religious groups. And also, I think in the UK, initial guidelines said that the cremation is the option. But then they also changed, I think, somewhere on 20th of March, saying that the burial also can be allowed if it is requested by the relatives on religious grounds. So we are also still thinking of amending the guidelines to allow the cremation, but with all restrictions. We don't have any data about the survival of the virus in the dead body. In fact, we have received the opinion from the College of Microbiologists also, how long this will be in the dead bodies. And at the moment, we are thinking of allowing the burial, but with all restrictions, and the whole process should be monitored by the PHI and the police and the MOH area. So I must tell you that we are ready, and in the case of death, we have distributed all the PPEs, and we have positioned as a consultant JMO to cover up the IDH and the Colombo East Base Hospital, and is positioned in the CBH. And so we are ready as a JMOs to handle the dead bodies if we get any.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. So we sincerely hope Ajit will not be required. And
exactly.
Yeah. So anyway, no harm being prepared and informing the medical officers and doctors in case. Okay, so now we have discussed many important areas. Any final messages from Dr. Ananda related to the clinical management, and maybe from the microbiologist related to infection prevention, and also from the community aspect, any final message from Dr. MC? Can we have very, very briefly? Any?
Can I just give two, three things from the observations? Briefly. First one is, there are over 25,000 doctors in this country working in the state and in the private. But we have to make sure these guidelines are read and adhered to by them. So there need to be not voluntary reading. We need to make sure that they read and they adhere to these guidelines. If not, we will have a problem of the safety of the healthcare workers plus the rest. That is the first thing. Second one is that we also have to be a bit conscious about the health system and the sustainability of the health system depending on the resources that we have. So we also have to look at, when we are taking decisions, to what extent the health sector and the health system could sustain within these resources in case that we may have to face a community outbreak, which we have still not been contained. And the third thing, which I personally think that we have to very clearly state, that we have to have a very clear plan for HR mobilization in the health sector. From the understanding that we have from talking to people across even these 30 hospitals that has been designated, we still may not be at the optimum level of thinking and planning on HR management. So these things, I think, is extremely important at this moment for the preparation for next couple of weeks. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Ananda, any final message for today?
Yeah, I think for doctors, I think we have to lead the team. So we have to get a correct picture of this. So as Manoj said, we have to read these guidelines, get a correct picture without getting panic. If you go into the panic mode, then nothing is going to work. So therefore, get the proper idea without believing what is going up in small groups of doctors or in the social media, there's adequate evidence published in WHO and other reputed websites, reliable websites, to take evidence from those and work on those and get your team organized and get things organized with adequate PPE and get the setup organized, then we should be able to face this.
Yeah, thank you. And from the microbiologist, is there any one message, key message for the doctors? Yeah, seems, Dr. Amita, one.
Unmuted.
Dr. Amita, any final message?
The mostly what the clinicians will require is numbers, projections of how this is going to progress over the next 2 weeks and build capacity. And the very important points raised about human resources and about all healthcare workers going to a single food outlet, and the quarantine process will be unimaginable.
Yes.
That would be a massive disaster. So I think that should be very clearly articulated, and we should be thankful for that view. And we should take necessary steps about that. And I think Kushilani also raised the valid point about a respiratory triage, because when the case definitions change and it becomes broader, we'll have to have a broader definition of this, and sorting out logistic issues like viral transport media, swabs, if we are running out of swabs, is saliva a good medium? I think the technical groups will have to sort out these issues and bring it to the attention of the highest authorities in the country.
I think just one more point, yes, if I can.
Yes, please.
As Dr. Amita was also looking at numbers, we are in the process of finalizing a prediction model at the moment. Possibly we can give some idea about what will happen within the next 2 to 3 weeks. Thank you.
Yeah, we need that. Yeah. Kushilani, briefly, if you want.
Sorry, I was waiting for Shirani to sum up, but if she's not available, I will just mention, because I think as microbiologists and infection control officers, we are worried. I mean, we think about everybody. So PPE, as we said, I mean, we have at the moment, but I think we have to be careful, because worldwide there's a shortage. We have to accept it. So therefore, we have to have a proper plan and some guidelines, and that.
Everyone need to learn how to put on and take off PPE. Consultants down, it is very important.
Yeah, I think we'll be sharing some of the health education material in our platforms as related to that. So education seems to be playing a major role, and there's a call for return to the very basic hygiene and the hand hygiene and so on and so forth, the basics of public health for prevention. And the PCR seemed to be the most reliable and the valid diagnostic method. So what we'll do is we'll share this information with all our members and also try to convey these important messages to the decision makers. And with that, we come to the end of this very important session. And I thank all of you. We have spent precious time with you, because we know that the current situation, all of you are very busy and dedicating your time for the country. So we really appreciate your dedication, not only the resource person, but all the participants, for sharing your views and then coming into some conclusions and showing us a pathway on how to proceed. So thank you all, and let's try to work together. Thank you.